So I'm here to take you, walk you through today's lab work. What we are going to do today is basically create a web service and deploy it, and then use that web service, call that web service in a client. So the functionality that the web service will provide is going to be similar to what we did yesterday in an exercise. We'll kind of create an operation, get secret code, which was told to you yesterday. It'll accept a group ID, and it'll return the secret code of the particular group. So what we can do is we can create the web service from scratch, write the whole code we wrote yesterday all over again. But instead, what we'll do is we'll use yesterday's code inside our today's web service. That's what we do object-oriented programming for, right? So let's start. As you can see, this is our yesterday's lab project. You can use the project you created if it is functional completely. In case it is not, you can use the one we distributed yesterday through the pen drive as a zip file. Just make sure that the XML file and the XSD file from the zip are extracted on your local disk, and the path of that XML file is edited in each of these parser Java files. Like you can see over here, make sure that this path points to the XML you've copied on your local disk. After doing this for each of this, my DOM parser, my JAXBY parser, and my SAX parser, you build the project and deploy it again. So now we'll start with our web service. We first have to create a new project.
Say, here you specify the path SRC slash something, okay? Instead yeah. of this, if I specify full path C colon something.
Yeah.
Anywhere you store that XML file, as to that path has to be specified, wherever it is stored.
There's nothing automatic about anything there. So what happens is that the program itself is expecting that the file will be in a certain path. Now that's what we just showed you in the code, right? Now if the file is not in that path, then there will be an exception thrown at that point in time. So you wherever the file, you can either create this path and store the file there, or you store the file anywhere you want and specify that path here.
Yeah.
So I don't know whether it will take the C colon backslash,
the backslash versus forward slashes.
XSD is different, XML is different. XSD is only required by XJSC.
For this particular application, it is not required.
Data values are defined in the XML file. And but if there is a backend database, then you would have JDBC or ODBC connectivity to.
Yeah. On the Java program, you can do JDBC connectivity, get all
the. Okay, so we proceed. We are creating a web application. We'll give some name like secret code web app. So now we actually are aiming to reuse yesterday's code. So we'll copy the package we created yesterday to this project. Yeah, it's been copied. And because in my yesterday's project, I have specified the path of the XML as src/groupdetails.xml. It's basically a relative path. So I need the XML in the relative path of the new project I've created also. So I'll have to copy the XML file as well in the new project. It's done. Okay. Now as sir has explained earlier, there are two ways of creating a web service. You can create it from a WSDL or from a POJO. We'll follow the WSDL method. So for the first step we need to do is create a WSDL which will define the web service and the various operations in it. So we right click on the project, point to new. Okay, the WSDL is not in this list, so we go to other. Was it there? Okay, anyways. I'll give it a name. Okay, now in this window you can specify a name for a port type. You can specify the you can specify operations basically. So we require to create one operation which will give us the secret code of the particular group ID. So we will give a name to the operation.
So remember that in the morning's presentation we went through that the WSDL would have an abstract part and a concrete part, right? The abstract part is a port type, which is basically consisting of a list of operations, every operation of a list of messages. So that's the first part that we're doing in here.
Yeah, the input we are providing is basically a parameter. It will be a string which will have the group ID. You just change the name of that. We'll click next. In this window you can specify a name for the you can specify a binding name. You can specify the different types of binding that are available. And you can actually you can do it later on after you create the web service. You can add more operations using the NetBeans ID. This wizard provides functionality only for one operation. Later on you can add more operations. I'll show you that.
How can we get information about those operations in
WSDL? That's what you are actually creating that operation, right? You are defining that operation. So you will add that data. You will add the data in the WSDL as well. So we can specify a binding subtype. Now this web service name can also be provided. We'll keep it as default. Let's finish. Yeah. So it has created a WSDL. I'll show you the source of the WSDL file. This is what it looks like. Now, as you were saying, if you need an extra operation, you can always this is a port type that is defined. For each under this port type, we've defined an operation get secret code through the wizard. If you want to add an operation, right click on this, add operation. You can define another operation create.
So the other way of doing this, you can handwrite your WSDL.
Yeah, right? you can handwrite the whole source code.
It's a good way of understanding how to do this if you handwrite once or twice. Right? IDEs make things simpler, but if you could, it doesn't have to come. These things give you all these wizards to help you create these
business
files.
Okay, so our WSDL is ready. Now we'll move on to actually creating the web service using this WSDL. We'll right click the project, new, and we can see here there's an option web service from WSDL. Okay. You can specify a package. I'll give the package name as web service. And we have to specify the WSDL we just created. So I'll go to the location of the project folder. Yeah, this is the WSDL we created just now. when the visitor is loaded, it automatically extracts the port name and the service name. It can be shown over here. This was automatically extracted from the visitor. You hit finish. Yeah, so what NetBeans did it using the WSDL, it generated a class for the service, and the WSDL defined one operation. So it has basically generated the code for that operation as well.
Skeleton.
Yeah, the basically the operation over here is just a skeleton. We have to implement some code in it. It will provide you with the skeleton. You will implement any kind of business logic you want to do. In our case, would be a our implementation would be returning a secret code. So here's the code that NetBeans generated. So we want to reuse yesterday's code, right? So we'll import that package into this Java file. Now we'll implement the operation. So you can see it has already generated a skeleton for this get secret code. We'll remove this.
So I think one more thing, point to be made.
Go ahead. So the other point is, before he removed that, there was a throw not supported exception was there, right? What it essentially means is that you can simply compile this whole project and deploy, and the service will be deployed. Only when you hit that particular operation, this exception will be thrown, but the end-to-end message cycle will be happening, right, from the web service client to the web service and back. It's just that the operation has not been implemented. The default implementation is to throw this exception. So at this point, even without doing anything, you can deploy a web service. Right, and actually write a client to hit it and just see whether it traverses that path and come back. So whether this exception comes back to you, it does.
Okay, so we'll now write our implementation. I've declared a string secret code. Now I'm going to use yesterday's parser class, which is my Jaxby parser. I've created an object of the my Jaxby parser class. Now I can call the get secret code operation of the parser and get the output assigned to secret code. So I'll do parser dot get secret code.
So all that pop-ups that you're seeing, right, this is all this IDE stuff. When you say parser dot, the IDE knows that the parser is of type my Jaxby parser. So it goes and looks at the class and it knows that this contains all these methods. So it knows that you're going to call one of those methods, so it will pop that list up. You can just select it instead of typing it, right?
Yeah. So now secret code will basically get the output of get secret code from the parser class. And we'll say return secret code. Okay, now the implementation is ready. We'll save this. So now we can see that our web service is complete. So we'll build this application. And we need to deploy it on the BlastFish server. So we'll make sure whether the BlastFish server is up. Okay, it's not up. So you need to go to services tab, open the servers tree, right click on GlassFish V2 and hit start. It'll take a while to start up. So it has started. We'll go and deploy our project. Right click, deploy. So our web service is now deployed at the GlassFish server. We now will create a consumer web application which will actually use that web service to display the result. Create a new project. This will again be a web application. We'll give it a name, consumer web app. Hit finish. Okay. Now, in the consumer web application, we basically are calling the web service. So we need to generate some kind of references to those deployed web services. So for that, we'll have to create something called as a web service client. We right click on the project, new, web service client. To create the client, it will again ask for the visdel of the web service. In our case, the visdel is already there in the project folder, so we'll access it from this option. Okay, finish. Okay, so as you can see over here, it has created a web service reference for secret code service. Now we'll use the web service client to call the web service, and we'll write that code in the JSP that, so that the result is displayed in the JSP. Now this index.jsp was created by default when we created a new web application. As you can see, it was created in the previous application also. We actually don't require index.jsp in secret code web application because the web service as such is not web service is not providing a GUI. It provides a machine to machine interface. So you actually don't require this index.jsp. You can delete it if you want. Now in the consumer web application, I'll write code in the JSP to display the result of the web service operation. So NetBeans provides us automated calling facility. You right click on the JSP page. There's an option web service client resources, call web service option operation, and you can actually select, it will give you the list of the operations provided by the web service, and select one operation, hit OK. It will generate code to actually call that operation. As you can see, it has created an object for the service. Implemented the port, and it has, using the port, it has called the get secret code operation. So by default, the default generated code specifies group ID as null. We can provide it. Say I want the secret code for group ID 5. I'll just modify this bit.
So a couple of things here. This when we got the visual and we said create a web service client, right? It generated a stop basically, write the visual and it said here's a Java class that I'm going to give to you. That you can access this web service. That's the stop, right? Terminology that we are using. So that secret code service is the stop, and the secret code service instance is being created, or the stop instance is being created, and then that is being used, right? So that if you want to relate it back to Moni's presentation, that's what it's going to be.
So the code says that the result is stored in this result variable. We'll just display it in a better way.
So
and we are done. We'll save this. Now our consumer web application is also ready, so we'll build it and deploy. It's been deployed. Now we can either run the web page through the NetBeans interface or open up a browser. And type in the whole URL. Specify a different port to the two different servers.
The Tomcat has not actually been started, I think, here, right?
Yeah, only we are using only Glassfish.
Glassfish server, which port it is?
8080. Some exception. Who's my? What is my new idea? Who is not able to do it? So what should we do?
Shift it up.
Look at that line in the core. So what is lock? In clock, so you are passing group ID, or you are passing
starts from.
What is the group ID you are giving to? For the
5.
The JSP hard code is a?
JSP.
Where?
सर्चिंग में देख रहा
हूँ ये नहीं है क्या सर्चिंग में नहीं है क्या नेटवर्क पूरा बात दे दे इसका लेकिन फाइल नॉट फाउंड एक्सेप्शन होना चाहिए था तू कर जाता है एक्सेप्शन
नो नो दैट ग्रुप आईडी दैट यू आर गिविंग कैन यू लुक एट द जेएसपी अगेन जेएसपी को वेयर इज द ग्रुप आईडी
दैट इज
go down. अगली चीज़ नीचे
group details.xml
का hard coded path दे दे उसमें
look what it's searching for
group.xml is okay src/group details.xml
हाँ that's what we are
let's see the whole path
domain config oh that is it is not taking from application
yeah
it's taking /config
yeah program file last page domain config this is not the path relative to where application has been deployed right
you just say /try /.
This should work maybe actually searching on this path
huh.
So there's nothing wrong with the code if you can see it.
This is the config /. This contain our application name. This is our seed in our application.
This is your project folder. This is being a project folder. But that's not a project folder. That's the glass page domain.
I'll try and tell Jack's page.
It's okay. Just
let me see whether it gives
a don't work. Don't work. You just browse to the group details.xml or who path did this.
Okay, just copy the file into this path that it's expecting. That's the better way of doing.
We remove src. First copy XML from here.
Okay, I know what the problem is.
So what is the default path that it searches by?
Usually it searches by...
It should be related to where the web application is deployed, the root. So how do you set the... Where will it go? You have to write a program to avoid the error. Yeah, how do you tell it to look
at
it? /. /. Will avoid the source, that's all. It's still going to conflict /.
/. /. /. /. /. Means current location.
For it's considering config to be the root. It's going to search from there and it's saying source /. That's all. Config. It's under config. Put it under config. You won't find it otherwise.
Config.
No, that's I'm looking for under source. You have to change your file also.
Okay, so the error which we were getting earlier was because of the fact which I had mentioned at the first step that group details.xml was not in the proper place. So here's a lesson: if we don't put it in a proper place, we might land up like this. So what had happened was, in my yesterday's project, I have specified the location of the XML as a relative path, as you can see. Now, what NetBeans, what GlassFish does it, if you deploy a web application through the NetBeans IDE, it just creates a reference to the the project folder on the local file system in the web server's library. So it doesn't actually deploy the whole jar file.
Solution.
Yeah.
You just put that double slash instead of a single slash. It will work.
Double slash where path, when you're searching.
You just put a double slash instead of a single slash.
When you're searching.
No, it works.
In the path you're saying before SRC.
Instead of SRC save.
After SRC, give two slash.
No, that works for backslash. We are not using backslash over here.
Yes, for this only I'm saying.
No, over here what is happening is it is trying to search groupdetails.xml in the GlassFish domain.
Correct.
Okay. But the whole project folder is not deployed in the domain because we deployed the project using NetBeans ID. Right. If we had deployed the project using a var file, that var file would have been expanded in the GlassFish domain itself.
So
in this case,
because that file object is not created here. The problem is with the argument which you are passing here, that is SRC slash. I mean, you keep.
I understand your point.
Double slash will work for programming.
Yeah, that's what it will create that problem if I had used backslash. Because backslash is an escape character in Java.
We'll suggestion, you can try that.
Yeah, sure.
Because I tried it, I was also getting a null.
Is this what you're suggesting?
I just made that change, I got the result.
Is this what you're suggesting?
Yeah, this is what.
Okay.
Compile and read it twice.
But now the file is anyway being copied under the GlassFish domain. It's going to work anyway.
No, I'll remove that.
Keep it where it was in SRC.
We can blow it away.
And even if you had it SRC, now it will work.
Okay, we'll remove that XML file from the location. Just searching it in config.
Domains.
It's searching under domain. Under source.
Rename for the.
Correct.
Don't remove.
Okay. Let us refresh this.
Yes, I know. No, but you have that SRC folder.
We renamed it, right?
SRC is less.
SRC is less.
Yeah.
SRC is there.
Relative to what is the question?
Say it is relative.
See,
even if you give an absolute bar. If you give us that only a single slash, it won't work.
It worked the first time, right?
No, it did not work.
Yeah, it worked the first time. I'll show you.
No, just before this it worked.
Yeah, just before this. At that time, it had SRC slash groupdetails.xml.
But if you not give only the file name, it will work.
What he is telling is just
give the file name.
Sir, I'm not saying that.
That is correct. That slash SRC is just removed from document.
Right now, groupdetail.xml is where it was before in SRC.
Okay.
Now, my only question, if you give an absolute path here, something in C,
C colon, something.
It will work perfectly. Yes. It will not perfectly.
There you need to give this double slash.
Yeah, that's what I said. See, because I gave, if you give an absolute path, it won't search for the groupdetails.xml in the domain, in the GlassFish domain.
Yeah.
because it is searching for, you have given a complete path. Because I have given a relative path, it was searching it in the domain which it did not find.
So basically, try to find out the SRC into the domain only.
Yeah, it was trying to do that. Exactly. Exactly.
Domain mein rename nahi karte to aa jayega.
Okay.
So how will you do the second method?
Yeah, that's all.
Huh?
That's all.
You are not going to do the other method?
That's all.
Right. My point is simple, that argument is incorrect. File object is not created, we are getting null pointer exception.
Fair enough, it's not from the file, we can fix it to find the file.
Okay,
that is not the point of the exercise. The point of the exercise mainly is to learn how to deploy the web service. Hopefully we have done that, right? I think that is what's important.
Yeah, purpose is served.
Which is what's critical.
So
the handout that you received, actually walks you through the steps that Vinay just went through. So you can actually try this in the lab or on your laptop. This, it can be done locally without a network connection if your client is going to be local to the relative to the web service. Everything is a local host, you can try it on your laptop. What we actually wanted you to do in the original exercise we had planned was that each group would create a web service and another group would access that web service. That was the notion, which you can still do actually. It's not that you can't do it because you deploy it, and when somebody writes a client, they can write a client to go to that particular host and pick it up and come back. It's not hard to do. Right? As long as you know the IP address of that machine.
So, for one time, you can repeat this.
What we are going to do is we are going to create a recording of it. It's just a recording in a tool called Win, and the recording is a file that will be available. Is the recording there with the exception fixing thing? Can we at least show a demo of that?
No.
Can
you show the demo?
Can you show a demo of that Win file that is still what you wanted to edit? Doesn't matter.
I'll have to create a live link right over here.
The Win file that you created that you said needs to be edited, can we just show that file? And this is what I'm asking.
I'll have to create a new one right now.
There's no Win file at all.
It's not on this laptop.
Okay. So, this is what we wanted to do even today, but so happens that we don't have that file tonight. That recording can be played any number of times to the hard drive. Right? Wherever. And you can repeat it at speed. And hopefully the handout also illustrates with screenshots as to how you would go through it. So, I think that should be enough. If you have specific questions, you should be glad to answer.
Sir, this secret code line here, secret group ID equal to 5 years later. But from outside parameter, if you want to give out, we can.
JSP.
It's just a JSP. You can have a form, pick it up from the form as a parameter.
Already, suppose we have 10 group IDs, you want to collect first 10 from the XML file, and then we will select. Suppose there are three group ID, 1, 5 and 7. So from X7 file, all the three will come and from Z you will select.
See, the parser that you have written on the other side will parse the XML file and will have methods that is available for you, the JSP parser that you created. Methods available for you to call to even a group ID, get the secret code. Whatever group ID you feed it with. How you get that parameter value is up to you. You can give it on a command, run it on the command line, give it on a command line, you can from a JSP, you can take it as a parameter and give it, write a form JSP, take it as a parameter and give it. Okay, any more questions about this? That'll be available later. We'll give it to you. Everything will, anything that we've shown here is going to be made available. So. Pardon? Which one? I gave it to everybody yesterday who was there in the lab. You can copy it for you today.
Huh?
No, on the last day we'll make
some soft copy of all the material for the workshop. But yesterday's code, we have put it on a folder and it is available for both download and autonomic, as well as I have it on a pen drive. I can give it to you, not a problem. But yesterday, a number of people copied it from me already. So, Glassfish. So it is the application for server for Sun. It will serve web content. It will serve as an app J2E app server. It will serve as a SOAP server. All the containers it has.
Yeah, what would that sound?
Apache Access is another server that you can use. Open source, free. This is also free, by the way, that you can download. Pretty much all the servers which were serving J2E content also serve SOAP today. Right? So WebLogic will serve, WebSphere will serve SOAP. And all of them are SOAP 1.2 compliant, pretty much. Can you just explain this? Because this is important for them to understand. So there, one thing that I would like you to pay some attention to is, remember we said that the true promise of service orientation can be realized with dynamic binding. Right, that you can dynamically discover a WSDL and create a request for operations corresponding to that WSDL and dispatch that request. Right? Here we have pre-created the stubs in the first example that we saw. Right, so we in the IDE we pre-created the stubs by creating a web service client, and then we built the application of the web service client that we had, and then we deployed it. Here is an example of the dynamic invocation.
In this, in previous cases where we have seen, we have created a stub and then we are calling, we are creating new service object and we are calling new service object from the stub which we have created, and then we are calling a port, a method in a particular port. But here in this case, when you are going to dynamically discover a service, what you will do is you will maybe pass a query to a UDDI registry or some standard registry which is there, and from that registry you will get service details. Maybe if you use UDDI, they have their own data structure in which they store service details. In that case, you will get a URL reference to WSDL, wherever the WSDL is stored. Now, here what we have done is service details dot get WSDL URL. If you look at this line, service equals to service dot create. It takes a WSDL URL and a service fully qualified name of service, that is service queue name. As a parameter, and it will go and fetch that WSDL, and in next line, if you see string request, this is your message which you want to send to the service. This is complete SOAP message. So you need to write SOAP message by your hand. So you must know what kind of SOAP message is expected from the service at the other end. Since you don't know the WSDL, I mean program doesn't know the WSDL, dynamically, when you are writing the code, you need to specify a complete message, whatever is expected by the service at other end. And after that, you create that message and you dispatch that message to the service endpoint. So dispatch method will automatically dispatch it to the point where service is deployed, to the service endpoint. Right? So here you need to only know the location at which your WSDL is stored. By that location and by knowing the SOAP message, you can dynamically invoke any service programmatically. But only requirement is, you, number one, you should know the WSDL location. Number two, you should know what format or what SOAP message is expected by the service. Those are the only two things you should know. So I think that explains. Okay, see, this create dispatch is creating a dispatcher for service. So it takes fully qualified port name as an input. Okay, so it will automatically fetch that port qualified name of that particular port from the details which you will get from querying a UDDI registry. Okay, so you will get all these details programmatically. I mean, UDDI has a very well defined data structure in which you can store all these details. So the one who is creating the service will publish all these details for you. As a client, you will go and query a UDDI registry. You will retrieve all this information programmatically. So since data structure is well defined, you can actually
access all these details very easily, programmatically, right? Because the data structure is standardized. So once you have these details, so you have fully qualified name of service, you have visual location, and you have fully qualified name of the port. By knowing this, these details, you can create a new dispatcher. You can create a new dispatcher. And for this, you must know the SOAP message which is expected by the service. So in this case, my service was having an operation called register for notification, or notification registration operation. Here is it. See. Now this contains namespace declaration, and then these are the parameters which are required. So condition, condition ID, and context type, all these are the parameters which are expected by service which is providing you this method. So since, so this message format must be known ahead of the time. When you are writing the code, you must know what format this message is expected. Exactly. See, current requirement of dynamic invocation, I mean current state of art technology only provides you this flexibility that you must know the message. So the interface, if there are 5 travel reservation services, we assume that all of them have same interface, or interface is known ahead of time.
Yeah, let me address that. The ideal scenario is that you don't know the format and they all have different formats, right? And you can still, by reflection, figure out what the current format that you pick is, and then construct that message, in which case, in here the string has been hard-coded, you will construct that message dynamically, right? With the CORBA dynamic invocation interface, or DII, you could actually do that. They gave you reflection APIs to figure out what were the types of the parameters that were expected on the server side, and the order of these parameters, and then you constructed that message. Here it's not yet possible to do that, but we can write additional code to try and accomplish something like that. There is no API available. Yeah. Well, it, at least the SOAP side of it is silent. We have to come up with something. For CORBA, the ORB had a DII API, as it was called. Anything else? Okay. So what we're going to go, we can head over to the lab now. We can take a break now. I think there is some T that is expected in 5 minutes or whatever, and then we'll head over to the lab and you can try this out. We'll be there to help you if you need help. Okay. Pardon?
And then allow you to just fill in bits and pieces of the class to call other implementations that you might have. So this is how you would wrap around an existing service. So if you had some service that was written in Java or Gateway, something else, to wrap on it, you would follow this process. That I'm sure.
Compliant with that. Okay. To create the web service using the second method.
Is it on?
Yeah. When you right click the project, there's another option which says create a web service. You can give a web service name, I'll keep it as default. And there are two options over here, create web service from scratch and create
SSD.
You provide a package name for the same.
Let me just say something, you set this up.
So this is creating web service on a session D. This is a NetBeans IDE. It is obviously built to take advantage of J2EE code that you might have lying on. Okay, so in J2EE code, you have these notions of session beans that you would have written to represent functionality that is going to be accessed by some client. It may be a string client, a JSP client, whatever. Right? So the NetBeans IDE is actually kind of optimized to take your J2EE classes and automatically turn them into web services. So if you have a session bean, you can just point it to that session bean and say, create a web service, and it will do a whole lot of stuff automatically for you. Right? If you don't, then you have to kind of do some things by hand for it to give you some support.
Yeah. So now before, even we haven't defined any visual, we are directly creating a web service. So the NetBeans ID will generate a blank web service class. We'll have to define our own operation in that. We'll write an operation. Okay. Let's use a NetBeans UI to create an operation. We have an operation, we have functionality over here to do that. The dialog box asks for a name. We'll write let us say this operation returns a string. And okay, it accepts something as a parameter. It accepts a name as a parameter. So the ID has generated a skeleton for the operation. But you, it's not the WSDL which has told the ID to generate this skeleton. It's you who specified it right now. We'll implement the operation right.
Just say something old annotation. You can start writing.
Yeah.
So notice that one of the things it has done when you generated the class in the first place was it provided an annotation to new web service one class saying it is a web service class. Okay, first of all, this class is going to be exposed as a web service. And next when you access the operation through the UI, it added an operation with another annotation called it's a web method. So in other words, this would be an operation in your web service which would be exposed appropriately. Now my other choice of doing that is I can handwrite these annotations easy enough with a simple annotation saying add web method, right? And I can just write the class without using any of these IDs. I can just take some kind of text editor, VI, Emacs, sit down, write a Java class and then provide the appropriate annotation. Right, GasWS has the appropriate hooks to read and understand these annotations and then generate a visual for me. This is the other way, going the other way, essentially. Starting from a Java class and generating the visual. Right, so you can also have methods that are non-annotated in here. It's just a regular class. I want to expose some of this as a web service, some of it I won't. Right, it's just implementation helpers for me, whatever. So those non-annotated methods will not be exposed as web services. So visual will be appropriately generated.
Is it possible to have a method which is a web method, but you are not declaring its class as a web service?
No.
No, that's
not. By default, if there is a web method, then it's a web service. Right, because this corresponds to an operation. A method corresponds to an operation.
Okay, so we have implemented the operation. We build our project and deploy it again. Now when you build the web service, the ID itself generates the WSDL for the web service.
You look at the generated WSDL?
Yeah, that's what I'm looking
for. It will hide it somewhere, that's the problem. Yes.
Now as you see, the tooltip shows the location of the WSDL that has been deployed on the web server. You type in that location, you will actually see the generated visual. This is a generated wisdom.
So, notice one more thing. Keep turning this on and off.
So one more thing that you notice is that we picked up this whistle from the server itself. So this was not a file that we picked up from the local file system. We contacted the server at port 8080 and said, give me the whistle that you have for your service. And it returned the whistle file. Right? This is exactly what would be done in a real situation, where you would actually retrieve the whistle from the server and then you would run your stub compiler, stub generator over that, and then it will generate the appropriate stub class. Rather than parting it to a file on a local file.
We also create the client for this web service in our original consumer web app itself.
I would like to add one thing here. In case you don't have NetBeans ID and you still want to create stubs, first thing you have to do is you have to go to jaxws.dev.java.net, which is JaxWS site. You need to download Java file from or the installer file from JaxWS site. Install it. I think the installer is similar, java-jar and Java file name. It comes as you have seen with JaxB, it comes with a program to automatically generate classes for you. There is a similar program for JaxWS also. It is called WS import. So whenever you are writing a client, you can give a visual as, so you can write WS import, visual and target directory. It will generate all these stub classes for you and you can actually browse through source and like this ID.
Okay, so moving on. We have the web service client dialog box. Over here, earlier we specified the WSDL pointing to the WSDL from another project. So now we'll try to simulate the real life scenario. We'll provide the URL of the WSDL which we have over here. We got this URL from the deployed from the server itself. We hit finish. The ID fetches the WSDL from the specified URL. It creates a web service client. Yeah, it's created. We'll call this web service in a JSP too. The same way. Searching for an XSD.
Where is the XSD? What is 10.29.33 or something?
Not this much. Go to say hello.
Okay. So we select the operation. Hit OK. By the way, that error was not relevant to our course of action. We generated the code. Here it is. We provide the operation with some name, say Siddharth. And we are done. We will build this application and deploy it.
Should say should we have used control S to save.
Oops. Let's try to access the JSP page. So it accessed the web service concatenated hello with the name and returned the result. So I think
so any other questions? If not, we'll take a tea break.